So this is my dad. I'm so proud in the moment, you know. He said, can I have a banana Jinx? And his response was, move, come out.
We may look different and live in different countries, yet our stories are knitted with the same threads of excitement, uncertainties, challenges, and victories. As we journey through the ups and downs of life, it is our undeniable will and God's strength that propel us to joy after pain, smile after frowns, and ups after downs. We were born to win. We were destined to greatness. We are overcomers. Welcome to God's Scoops, Raw and Unedited Stories. Welcome to Raw and Unedited Stories, the place where stories are told to uplift, encourage, and brighten your day. Thanks to those who have already subscribed. And if you have not done so, now is the time to help us share stories that are uplifting. With us today is a very special gentleman, Pastor Napoleon Black, to share his story. Who is Pastor Napoleon Black? Welcome. Welcome, Pastor Napoleon Black, to Raw.
Thank you, my friend.
Thank you for sharing your story with us today.
Thank you.
What's your story?
A very simple story. A story of a little boy born in Deep St. Elizabeth, just outside of the, or off the Holland Bamboo Roads, in a village there, Holland Village. A lot of what we grew up on in our village was largely the African retentions, you know? Mm-hmm. Gumbe, Mialism, Revivalism. We're steeped in those traditions in our village at the time. I'm sure by now a lot of those have changed. So much of what we knew then came out of that tradition. My mother had me when she was about 16 or so, maybe going on 17. And having to grow up in that kind of setting, she herself being a ward of the state, not having identified parents at the time, and the struggle that she went through. Actually, she was grown by another family, not her biological parents. And that family really became my family. And they mean the world to me as well. Finding my identity there, growing up with my siblings in that space as well, as life unfolded in that quaint, quiet space. Not knowing my father until perhaps I was about 10 years old, and that's a whole story by itself, because there are so many of our Jamaican young men who have grown up not recognizing, knowing, or perhaps just hearing stories about dad until at some later point in their lives and in their stories.
Yeah.
So that's how this story begins for me.
That's a very interesting background. Yes. So tell our listeners, what are some of the struggles you faced growing up in that community and without your father?
One of the things that marked us was the sense of that sense of community, that we understood that we belonged to each other. So every home was our home. Every adult was our parent. Every child was our brother, our sister, in that sense. We grew up poor, dirt poor. We didn't wear much clothes, and such clothes as we had really was just mainly to cover our very private areas. It didn't even matter, you know. We grew up barefooted on the roads, in the homes. We didn't have TV. We had just in our home, for instance, we just had one radio. we didn't have electricity, we didn't have running water. We went to the river to bathe, actually to the Holland Estate canals, really, and so on. And that's where our space was. We did not grow up on breakfast and lunch and dinner. We ate mangoes and cashews and cane. Those are the things that we fed on as we evolved in that space. So it was very quaint, very quiet. The first person who brought electricity actually brought a Delco plant to our village. And when we hear that Delco plant roar in the evenings, that was something for us as a community. And then the lights come on. Just a very different person, first person who brought a television, as it were. And that was how our village was in those very, very early days. And our parents, they didn't have any of the top jobs. They grew up as estate workers, mostly planting cane, reaping cane, mulching cane. Some eventually ascended to a foreman position, but pretty much the people in our village worked on the Holland Estate in that and in those kinds of capacities. Some had their own little farm, planting peanuts or planting yam or something, planting bananas and so on, just to eke out an existence in that space. So we didn't have much of the other kind of life, so to speak. That's where we were, that's how we understood life, and that's what we thought was going to be our Latin life. We'd grow there, live there, and die there. And be buried in the Holland Cemetery around the back of the property.
Right. As I listen to your story, I'm thinking you're a man 100 years old, because I can't imagine that lifestyle at a man who is at a younger man. So, wow, that's pretty interesting. And it sounds like a fairy tale book. Tell us a little bit about that fairy tale lifestyle as you got older into your 20s and how it impacted you or impressed you.
Oh, perhaps the transition, perhaps, is 1979, passing the common entrance exams. Holland School only produced one or two scholarship winners every year. And that year, Errol Mitchell, my very, very dear friend, his name appeared in the papers to go to Monroe College. And you can just imagine the disappointment that my parents felt that, okay, the only way out of Holland Village was an education and to go to Monroe. But there was an uproar that year across the nation, because the idea was that even though children did well, there was not enough space for children to be placed in the available high schools. However, because of the uproar that year, there was a subsequent list, and my name appeared in that subsequent list. And thanks be to God, a new journey began for me as a student of the inimitable, indescribable Monroe College.
Wow.
I would not give up those 7 years of my life for anything, in significant ways. It's there significantly that I began to see life in a brand new kind of way, outside of the limitations of my little village in Holland. I began to see people from all walks of life. I began to understand the dynamics of success and wealth and well-being. There's a boy there who had a top box with 15 tins of milk. I had only seen one tin of milk in at any one time in my house.
Yes.
We were now given an egg every morning for ourselves. I never had an egg for myself before. No, whatever egg there was, that egg had to be cut in 3 and 4 pieces and shared between my brothers and sisters and myself, and that was it for us. So here was a kind of shift in terms of understanding that life was much more expansive than my little village frame. It was a space in which, as well, you began to discover what learning was. And I had a deep hunger for learning. It was a place as well in which you began to connect with other people who wanted to show you a different way of living, who wanted you to think differently educationally, but also relationally. Men who began to just pour themselves into my life, and that was just awesome. Significantly too, that's where there was a chapel there at Monroe College, and I gave my life to Jesus Christ, the most significant event of my life. To a song that says, "Hallelujah, not as orphans are we left in sorrow now." And in that space, I bowed my head before Jesus, and he became my Lord and my Savior in that chapel at Monroe College in those formative early days.
Praise God. Praise the Lord for that.
Yes.
And that was a turning point.
It was, absolutely.
Yeah, and tell us.
So my philosophical frame changed, my spiritual frame changed, my outlook on life changed. So much so that in many ways, I emerged as leader over my 7 years at Monroe in ISCF, Interschool Christian Fellowship. In the student council, I became student council president. I became head prefect and all kinds of amazing things. As the Lord began to shape me into a particular journey, in a particular path that he wanted for me. From those early days, unknown to me, he was shaping me for life, for ministry, for leadership, and in significant ways, redirecting me in the path that he wanted me to follow.
Awesome, awesome. So tell me, at what point did you decide to become a minister?
But I've always known. I've always known. My mama, Mama Elsie, Mama Enid tells me that I used to preach to the trees. She tells me this. I don't even recall it, but she says, yeah. I remember very, my first experience of myself as a person was I was being held in the hand of a man who was preaching in my mind appears to be a church still. That's my first recollection of myself. So in a sense, I've always known this direction and call on my life, even though I had no idea how it would frame or what it would look like. So it was almost a kind of call from my mother's womb notion. In that sense, and then watching it unfold as he calls me, as he directed me in those ways. So I'm at school, I am leading inter-school Christian fellowship, both juniors and seniors, as my life evolved in those directions. So from then I knew, but as well, I was involved with the Bible Society of the West Indies from a very, very early age as a junior representative, and worked with Mr. Richard Rober, who was Monroe's head prefect, headmaster at the time. Mm-hmm. And that too helped to give me some stability. Then we had persons who were very, very serious about studying the Word, his son, Kevin Roper. And we would meet at their house and would study the Word and would get our depth and our feasting on the Word in those early days. A lot of what I have come to appreciate have been centered in those very, very early days at Monroe.
So I've seen a life of starting from grassroots,
yes,
to coming into purpose.
Mm-hmm.
As I talk to you, tell me something in your life that you could have changed if you could. Is there anything?
Oh, my. There are so many things. My journey with my dad didn't start out the way I would have liked. As I said, I didn't know him initially. Met him again in the village when I was about 10 years old. Very, very unpleasant circumstances. Here comes this man riding into the village. He rides up to the shop where we were. My boys and I were just playing together. Me, Tony, Gary, Blue, Denzel, all of us were on the roadside. Of course, skimpily clad as was the norm for us. The shop in Igiri. There's your boy. He says, "You boy, come here." I go into the shop. I look at him. He looks at me. I'm this debonair man. I said, this is my dad. I'm so proud in the moment, you know?
Yeah.
And he says to me, what do you want? And I looked around because I'm not quite sure what the question meant. So I said, can I have a banana jinx? And his response was, move, come out, go away. I was humiliated. I held my head down and I walked out and I was met by Gary, Tony, Blue. And did they laugh at me in that moment as I met my dad in those first moments? It was horrible.
I can't imagine how crushing that must have been.
It was absolutely crushing. Would I change it if I could? I absolutely would. That's not the way I would have wanted to have encountered my dad for the first time. Mind you, I already had a picture in my mind about who he was, because at PTA meetings and those things at Holland Primary School, people wanted to know, where's your dad? And I had amazing stories about my dad. He was, if you see an airplane flying past, that's my dad. He's on some important assignment, so he can't come to these little meetings, you know? So, So I had created an imagination of just who he was. And then having that kind of encounter, initial encounter with him was painful. It was difficult. I didn't see him for a few years thereafter. I think I next saw him when I had passed a common entrance exam. And then he had come to just show me off to his friends. This is my boy, who was passed to go to Monroe.
Mm. And how did you feel at that time? How did you feel?
Pride at the connection.
Mm-hmm.
That he was then celebrating me, but also the pain of him not having been around.
Mm-hmm.
And the pain of a mother who has sought to get him to connect with me, taking him to the court to get him to take care of me. But he and all the policemen were friends and so on. So nobody would serve in the summons or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
He was well known, well established, well loved, well respected by that group. So it really didn't matter. And in any event, I was not his only child. He had so many children all over the place. Later on in my very, very adult life, I was to meet a sister who I knew existed but never met. And I have brothers and sisters that I've never met. And I am as old as I am now. So it's a part of his story and a part of my story. And learning some things later on, even after his death, just his own journey and how he came to have lived the life that he has lived. It's for another story.
Mm-mm. Pastor Black. The church is a spiritual hospital.
Yes.
And we have many myriads of people going to church with similar stories.
Yes.
And I know that when the Lord handpicks his people to serve, he doesn't pick perfect people. He picks people who can empathize. So talk to us about your journey of serving and empathizing with others who have been through the same.
You know, as you say that, Pat, one of the things that come to mind is how training clashes with reality. So, for instance, we are taught in our training, don't tell people that you understand what they're going through. You're not a part of their story. You don't know their story. So I'm sitting in my office with a lady, and she's pouring out her heart, and I'm saying to her, I could never understand what you've been through. I could never understand the pain that you face. And she was offended. She said, but you have to understand.
Mm.
I need you to understand. And if you're not understanding, then what am I doing here? So she wanted somebody who would come in her story, not only to hear her, not only to show compassion, but to be able to walk in her space with her, as it were,
mm-hmm.
so that I become incarnational in her space in that sense, you know? And this is what I think the distance between what we do in the training and what happens on the ground in terms of people's lives and experiences and stories, that people want to know that you know their story and you are understanding what is happening to them, where they are. So for instance, many people, the lady who sells out here at the gate, many people call her Punky. Everybody knows her as Punky. And she doesn't mind. But my thing was to go to her and say, tell me your name. What's your name? And we sat down with a good conversation. Her name is Barbara Matthews. And I from then on, I called her Barbara, or Miss Barbara. So that her sense of identity is not just tied up in what she sells, but how she was named and who she is as a woman. And what's your name? Her relatedness in that space, and when she closes the stall and she goes home, how she functions and how she lives out there. We get to serve in a very, very exciting space here at Marvely. And we meet all kinds of people with all kinds of stories. In COVID, for instance, there was a lady who came. We had just planned the funeral service for her daughter, and then government has said no more funerals. That perhaps was one of the most difficult moments in serving here. And I'm trying to say to her, sis, we can't have the funeral. And she sits in front of me, she bursts out in tears, and she says, somebody have to go bear me picnic like a dog. At the thing hit me, you know? And just having to walk with her through this new space that COVID had imposed on us to make her feel validated, to walk with her through the funeral service, because of course we could not only go to the cemetery, very few persons, none of the normal things we would do in a funeral service in that space. So it was very, very painful, very, very difficult. And helping her and her family through that very difficult, strange situation that had come upon us as a world, as it were, and specifically for her in that space.
And as I
learning to work with people. Go ahead, Pat.
No, as I speak with you, I'm thinking of the life of our Savior Jesus Christ when he came down in our situation as man, and when he selects servants, because pastors are servants, then he wants us to be able to connect with the pain that others go through.
Yes.
And it's not easy. So how do you separate when you go home, when you take on so many burdens? How do you separate? Because I'm sure many pastors will be listening to you. How do you separate and live and not say, go to your bed and take Mary and Josh and Peter to your pillow? Talk to us about that quickly for this interest of time.
Yeah. Thanks, Pat. It is, first of all, knowing that you are not on a pedestal. You're a servant. Do not allow anybody to pedestalize you. It's a dangerous place to be. Helping people to see you as you are, with all of your imperfections, all of your flaws, so that that too will help them in their journey, that this person is not God, is not perfect, may have a little bit more training, may have a little bit more experience, may have a little bit more wisdom for a number of reasons and so on, but he's still one of us. He's still walking among us as one of us, and that's important. Secondly, is having people around you who you can trust. I have my own group of Teddy and Brent and Robert that we meet and we talk and we process our own heart, our own stories, our feelings, our strengths, our weaknesses, our dreams and so on. So when we talk, when we meet, we have that space in which we interact and we share openly and freely with each other without judgment and without any sense that we're covering up anything with each other, you know? Mm-hmm. So we have that space as well. It's a respectful space, it's a firm space, it's a safe space, but it's the space in which we seek to honor God in how we relate with each other.
Yes, you do. Yes. Mm-hmm. So you do need support.
Absolutely.
As a leader.
It's critical.
Coming from Little District.
Holland Village.
To a superb student, to a servant of the Lord. And now I've heard that you have written several books.
Yes.
Talk to us briefly about those literature and how impactful they are to the lives of believers and others.
Oh, mercy. I love writing. It's been my heart from my youngest days. When he ascended, the first of the works that I've done talked about the gifts of the Holy Spirit for the church and how important they are. And strangely, I'm brethren and writing about spiritual gifts. Some people find very, very odd, but I think it's important we understand them and how they apply to the Christian journey. Then there's a crucified life, which takes a hard look at what it means to live out the Christian life in a space that does not embrace discipling and crucifixion. If we're going to follow Jesus, we must give up everything and embrace the cross and follow Jesus. And that's so important in the unveiling of the Christ life for community and how we live that out. The last work I have done that's published is Light Afflictions. And Light Afflictions, again, take that hard look at what it means, now that we have embraced the cross, how are we managing contentment and the message of contentment in a world that seeks to answer contentment, not from the biblical paradigm of joy in the Holy Ghost, mm-hmm. but in all the various ways that people seek to try to satisfy the deeper hunger of the heart. And we find that the way to do that as Christians is embracing the afflictions that come and finding that in the afflictions, we find meaning and purpose and fulfillment. And as we grow in those, others are seeing us, others are learning and understanding where God wants to take us through those battles.
Praise God. My final question for the sake of time, did you reconcile with Dad? And how important is that?
Yes.
For men to reconcile with parents in leadership.
Yeah, I had the privilege part of leading my dad to the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And to be able to say, I love you, Dad. And my father say to me, know that I'm adult, with tears running down his face and tears running down my face, I love you, son. One of the most significant moments, I think, of my adult life, when we were able to connect after a kind of turbulent growing up. But yeah, and to see him reconnect with the Lord, begin to live out that Christian journey and all of its implications and what it meant for him as a man and as a husband and as father, very, very significant. So I'm very, very proud of him. I'm very, very proud of how my life has been impacted in significant ways by him being my father. The significant life traits that I have, that he gave me, even without the connection, but I am who I am in significant ways because of who he was. You know, and I'm very, very thankful to God that I am the son of Orville Black, and I thank God for that.
Praise God. And the broader question.
Yes.
Before we close this session, speak in the life of the servants in our communities who are still hurting and still serving, just briefly speak in their lives now?
Different ones of us come to ministry with great expectations. My spiritual disciple, Courtney Richards, tells us as we meet with him from time to time, sometimes we see ourselves doing great things, and the great thing that we can do and may do may not seem to measure up in this world, by this world standard. What we ultimately will hear is, "Well done, you good and faithful servant." And we live our lives in light of that reality. We recognize that in our own journey we fail. We recognize in our own journey that for many we'll never make the grade, we're never good enough. But we are not afraid of those things because of the mark of Christ upon us that empowers us, that emboldens us, that prepares us to face circumstances and situations that we never thought were possible. It is the empowering of the Holy Spirit in those circumstances and situations that make the difference. When our marriages crash around us, when our children are disobedient and disrespectful, when churches don't respect or honor us, when our friends have expectations of us that we can't meet and measure, when the deeper hunger of our souls seeks satisfaction in places where we hope that we'd find it, but it doesn't happen, and the frustration that comes and the challenges that come in those moments, we understand them and we recognize them for what they are, and they're just part of the journey. The call is just to remain faithful, to remain steadfast.
Amen.
Know that your life doesn't end in your grave. Your life doesn't end at a funeral service, because there's a God who keeps records. And you will hear from your Savior, "Well done, good and faithful servant."
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Black. Pastor Napoleon Black. And I know you have another name. What is it? Remind me.
I don't know what you're talking about, Pat. Back then they call me Mark.
Mark, yes. Pastor Napoleon Mark Black. I know there's another hierarchy name. I can't remember it. Yes. Thank you for joining us on Raw and Unedited Stories on God's Scoop. We are just delighted to have you, sir.
Thank you.
What a blessing. And to our viewers and those who are listening, thank you for tuning in to Raw and Unedited Stories. And remember, those who have already subscribed, thank you. And for those who have not, now is the time to do so. And if you have a story to share, you can put your information in the description section below and we will reach out to you. And you have yourself a phenomenal day.